So thanks a lot for, you know, to the organizer, and you know, I'm very, very impressed by this very warm welcome in Dublin. And you know, I should first apologize for my very bad pronunciation of your beautiful language. And you know, I hope this will be okay. So I'm going to try to tell you a little bit about this book. Let me first, you know, also apologize for having written such a long book. And you know, I think it's a readable history of money, a readable history of income and wealth, but it's a bit long. That's probably the main problem. On the other hand, you know, the reason why it's long is that, you know, I'm trying to put in this book a lot of historical material. So basically, this book tries to study the global dynamics of income and wealth distribution since the 18th century in over 20 countries. So of course, you know, if I was doing that in 100 pages, you would find it a bit strange. You know, I try really, this book, I really want to emphasize, is based on a very, international project. First started working on the history of income and wealth inequality in France about 15 years ago. Then with Tony Atkinson, this was extended to Britain, and Tony himself studied many other countries. With Emmanuel Saez, we did it for the United States. Facundo Alvaredo worked on Argentina, Abhijit Banerjee on India. Brian Nolan did it for Ireland, and you know, other scholars from Ireland and from dozens of countries, you know, contributed to this work. So this is, you know, there is no way I could have collected all this data on my own. So, you know, all the mistakes that are in the book are my own mistakes, but the data that I use is, you know, comes from a huge collective project of data collection. You know, I think this is the largest existing historical database on income and wealth inequality. But let me also say that this is still too little. You know, we know too little. We know a bit more than we used to. So that's we are making progress. That's good. But we still, you know, we are in the domain of the social sciences, and we are not going to come with you know, mathematical certainties about you know, what should be done and what explains what we observe in history. So, you know, in particular, part four of the book includes a number of conclusions about the future, but let me tell you very clearly that, you know, I am much better at analyzing the past than the future, and you can perfectly disagree with everything that's in part four, and that's fine with me. You know, I think you can still find some interest in part one, two, and three, even if you disagree with my conclusion. And ultimately, you know, the objective is to provide people more data so that they can write their own part four. And, you know, these issues about income and wealth are too important to be left to economists alone. And they are of interest to everybody. And the objective of the book is to sort of give access to this historical material to more people. And so, I will talk more about the policy conclusion in the question time, but during this presentation, you know, I will not talk too much about the policy conclusion of the future. You know, I have also written recently with a number of other people in Europe a manifesto for a closer political union of the Eurozone, and you know, I'd be happy to talk about that in the question time, but this is not going to be really what I'm going to be talking about in this presentation now. So right now I'm going to present, you know, some of the historical evolutions that I present in the book, and you know, we can talk more about the future in the discussion if you want. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit more about the kind of data sources that we've been putting together in this book. So there is really two different data sets, one that's more about income and one that's more about wealth. So of course, wealth is partly the accumulation of saving out of income, so the two are related, but it's not exactly the same data sources and the same issue. So the data on income comes mostly from this database, the World Top Income Database, that's available online for everybody. And so the countries in red are the countries that are already in the database. And the countries in blue are about to enter the database. So, you know, we have updated in this database almost every week, and we will continue to update the data as new data and better data for more countries come. So what being in the database means is that we use all the historical income, and now we are also putting the wealth data, but initially it was the historical income data, going back usually to the creation of the income tax in every country. Okay? So the income tax was created in 1913 in the United States, in 1914 in France. In Britain, there was an income tax starting in the 1840s, but it became progressive in 1908, 1909. And you know, in India, it was created in 1922, in Argentina in 1930, in Japan, Germany, and a number of Nordic countries, it was in 1880, 1890. In most countries, you know, this is between 1900 and 1920 that the modern income tax is created, which is, you know, that's an important date in the history of taxation, but that's also an important date for the for scholars, because this means that you start to have data on income. So, you know, taxation, and I think it's important to have that in mind, it's not only, it's always more than taxation, it's also a way to produce legal categories and transparency about income and wealth. So, you know, when there was no corporate income tax in the 19th century, you didn't even have company accounts to compute taxable profit. So it's not that the book accounts are always reliable today, but, you know, at least they exist. So that's better than when you have no. So starting in 1913 in the US, 1914 in France, etc., you have historical income tax data, and you can study. So the evolution of the share of income going to the different groups in society. So the first economist to do that was Kuznets in the 1950s, who was the first economist to compute national accounts for the United States, to compute GDP series for the US. And then the next step that he did was to use the federal income tax data in the US from 1913 to 1948 to compute the share of national income going to the top 10% of the distribution. And all what we've been doing with Atkinson, Saez, many other people, is really to extend what Kuznets had done, but to over 20 countries instead of one, and to an entire century instead of 35 years. So let me show you an example of what we get. So this is the evolution of the share of total US primary income, pre-tax income, going to the top 10%. So this is a big decline in inequalities that Kuznets found. And, you know, Kuznets was right. You know, we redid the same computation using the same data, and he didn't have Excel or so, but he did the computation right. And so, indeed, Kuznets in the 1950s came with a relatively good news, which was a reduction of inequality. As you can see, the share going to the top 10% went to, you know, 45-50% in the 1920s to, you know, 30-35% starting in the 1950s. But what we add to that with Emmanuel Saez is, you know, the recent period show a complete reversal of the trend, and, you know, the share going to the top 10%, you know, has increased from 30-35% in the 1970s to almost 50% today. In fact, the latest data point for 2012 is even a little bit above 50%. Okay, so it seems to be continuing to go up, but when the book was written, I had data only until 2010, but now data for 2012 shows that it's a bit over 50%. So, of course, it gives a very different picture from what Kuznets had in the 50s, because Kuznets, you know, in the 50s and 60s, 70s, you know, had this very optimistic view that you have a decline and then a stabilization of inequality in advanced stages of development, and this had a profound impact on economic thinking at that time. And, you know, and indeed, you know, in the 50s, 60s, 70s, you know, you have a very stable share going to the top 10%, which means that everybody was benefiting from growth at the same speed. Okay, so if you have a total GDP growth rate, well, you know, the top 10% has the same share, so they have the same growth rate as the average, the bottom groups have the same share, so it's really a very smooth process. Whereas in the recent period, you know, it's important to have in mind that, you know, this has been a very large rise. Most of it, actually, is due to the top 1%. So, you know, some of it goes to the people, the 9% below the top one, but most of the increase in the top 10 is due, percent share is due to the top one. And you know, the numbers are really very large. You know, some people say, well, you know, okay, it's only a few top managers who are making a lot of money, but, you know, this has become a macroeconomic issue. You know, in the United States, when you have 15% of total income going from the bottom 90 to the top 10, you know, it's a huge transfer of income and huge change. So you have to, at some point, you have to take the number seriously and you have to ask yourself, okay, how far is this going to go? And, you know, so some people seem to believe that wherever it goes will be fine, but, you know, I think this is not serious. If you know, if this goes to 60%, 70%, you know, is it going to stabilize right there? You know, the numbers are so big that, you know, it's important to pay attention to them, whatever your political persuasion. And as a matter of fact, what we show in a number of research papers with Emmanuel Saez, Stephanie Stancheva, is that, you know, it's not clear that this huge rise in top managerial compensation in the United States, you know, can be justified by productivity or performance consideration. You know, we've been putting a big database with all publicly traded companies in North America, Europe, Japan, and trying to see whether, you know, when you pay your manager 5 million rather than 1, or 10 rather than 5, or 50 rather than 10, do you get more performance, more job creation? And, you know, you don't see it in the data. So if, you know, if the performance of large corporation and the performance of the US economy as a whole had been excellent, you know, with a huge growth rate, you know, maybe rising inequality would be okay. But if you take the per capita GDP growth rate between 1980 and 2010, you know, it's about 1.5% per year over this 30-year long period. So, and this rise means that about three quarters of total growth went to the top 10. So, you know, if you have a 1.5 growth rate and three quarters of it goes to the top 10, you know, that's not a very good deal for the rest of the population. And I think many people now in the US believe that this has contributed not only to the stagnation of median incomes but and to the rise of household debt, but to this contributed to probably to make the financial system more fragile. And so, you know, this is not funny anymore. So you know, in Europe, the rise in top income shares has been much less dramatic. So if you were to put continental Europe and Japan and Ireland and Britain, you know, you would have a rise in top income shares, but it would be much less dramatic than in the US. Now, that's, you know, that's, it's not a coincidence if, you know, Occupy Wall Street happened in Wall Street in New York rather than in Brussels or Tokyo. You know, the rise of top income shares has been much more dramatic in the United States. You know, that's not necessarily a reason to wait before it becomes as large as in the US to start worrying about it. Anyway, the rise of top managerial compensation is an important issue that I deal about in the book, but this is not the central issue of the book. And by and large, what I'm going to talk to you in the rest of the talk and most of the book, you know, is really trying to shift the attention from the rise in top managerial compensation and top labor income to the dynamics of wealth accumulation and wealth distribution. So, of course, the two are related. You know, if you have a huge rise in top managerial compensation, at some point this will contribute to create large accumulation of wealth. But there are really different forces going on. So in particular, I'm going to show you now another U-shape evolution, but which in fact is completely different. You know, it could go together, but it actually comes from different economic processes. And this is the evolution. So on this graph, you know, it looks a little bit like the previous one, but it has, in fact, nothing to do, basically. It's a very different process. So this is the evolution of the what I call here the capital income ratio, which is the total value of, so here this is the total value of private wealth, and I will come to public wealth in a minute, but as you know, governments are poor these days, so public wealth is not very big. So private wealth, this is what households own, okay? So this is real estate assets, financial assets minus financial liability. So this is the net wealth of the household sector divided by national income. National income is like GDP minus capital depreciation and also minus income going abroad, which is something you know about in Ireland. So as you can see, this ratio of capital to income, you know, as so this is for three European countries, but for the other European countries for which we have data, we have similar evolutions. You can see that, you know, there was a lot of wealth relative to income until World War I, a huge decline following World War I, World War II. And then you have a process, you know, a very long process of increase in the ratio of capital to income. Now, let me say right away that there is nothing bad in this rise of capital to income ratio. You know, it's good to have capital. You know, it's good to have a lot of buildings, to have a lot of assets. This can create problem of inequality in property, but you know, the fact that we have a lot of wealth, a lot of capital relative to income, there's really nothing bad about that. And you know, we live at a time in Europe where we talk a lot about debt, private debt, public debt, and you know, it's actually good news that you know there's been a rise in assets that has been even bigger than all the rise in debt. So, you know, this raises problem of organization, of taxation, of institutions. But you know, it's better. You know, it will be much worse if we only had debt. So it's you know, the fact that we have a high capital to income ratio per se does not tell you anything about inequality. You know, if everybody had an equal share in capital, because you know each worker owns part of his company, everybody has owns a piece of the real estate capital, you know, that would be perfectly fine. Okay, so here there is nothing, so that's why it has really nothing to do with this graph. This graph is the share of total income going to the top 10%. This other graph could happen in a perfectly egalitarian society. Now, the problem, of course, is that we are not in a perfectly egalitarian society, and the inequality of capital property is actually even larger than the inequality of income that we have on this graph. But, you know, it could be differently. So, anyway, in this presentation, you know, I'm going to make, well, I'm not really going to talk about the third point. You know, I'm happy to be back in Europe after a couple of talks in the United States, and so I will forget about the third point and focus on the first two points. So the first point in this talk, you know, I already just show you a graph, is about what I call the return of a patrimonial or wealth-based society in Europe and also in Japan. In Japan, you very much have this same evolution. And whereas in the United States, you know, you have the rise in top income shares, but you don't have such a strong rise, well, at least it's less strong than in Europe and Japan for the rise of wealth to income or capital to income ratio. Okay, so wealth to income ratio, you know, in effect, seem to be returning to very high levels. Why do they do so, particularly in Europe and Japan? Well, because these are low growth and, in particular, low population growth countries. So it's important to remember that population growth historically has been a big part of GDP growth, typically half of GDP growth historically. And now population growth is going to zero, or sometimes it's already negative in a number of European countries and in Japan. And this per se implies you know, the intuition is that in a slow growth society, wealth accumulated in the past can naturally become very important. And in the very long run, you know, this could be relevant for the entire world. Now, this, as I said, you know, is not necessarily bad per se if we all have, you know, reasonable access to property. Now, the problem is that property, you know, wealth concentration is typically very large. So my second point will be about the long run evolution of wealth inequality. And okay, this is a very complicated issue. This depends on many different parameters and saving behavior by income group, wealth group, and you know, it's there's no way I can predict the evolution for the entire world for the next decade. But there's one force that I would like to pinpoint among many other forces that will play an important role, is the gap between R and G, where R is the net of tax rate of return to wealth, and in particular to large wealth portfolio, and G is the growth rate. And what I will argue is that when you have a higher R minus G, then wealth inequality tends to converge to very high levels. It doesn't go to infinity, but it goes to very high levels. But you know, it's different policies, different institutions, in particular tax policy, can allow to have a less unequal equilibrium. Okay, so this will be the two points that I will make. Okay, so let me start with point number one. So, I'm not going to spend too much time on definitions. Let me just remind you that here in this talk, you know, wealth
or capital, you know, will be used in the same definition, and this includes everything, all assets that we own and that can be sold in a market. So let me say right away that, you know, when you make this big sum of all assets that household or the government own, you know, you are really doing something quite abstract, and we should always be, you know, very careful about this. And, you know, in the book, I really try to show that the history of capital is always a multidimensional story. You know, the story of real estate is not the same as the story of public debt, the story of business assets, financial assets. You know, inflation has a very different impact on all these assets. Real estate prices, as you know, sometimes go up and down. And you know, it's very important to take into account this multidimensionality of capital that you, if you want to understand everything that's going on. So when we make this big addition of the market value of all assets, you know, we should be careful about what we are doing. Still, you know, this is a useful indicator to measure, you know, the overall importance of wealth and assets in a society. And so, according to economic textbook, the ratio between wealth and income is supposed to be a constant. Now, you know, you should be very careful with textbook. You know, sometimes when we don't know much in economics about something, we just assume it's a constant. And, you know, if you only have one data point, of course, everything is a constant. But in fact, as you know, as I have shown you already, what we observe is that this ratio, which I will call beta, between wealth and income, you know, it's not a constant at all. It has increased from, in Europe and Japan, it has increased from 200-300% in the 1950s-60s to 500-600%. So what this means is that, you know, average wealth was about 2-3 years of average national income per capita, and it's now 5-6 years. Okay? So the big question is, you know, is that going to continue? What kind of level are we going to converge to? You know, how can we think of the balance between wealth and income in the long run? And again, there's nothing bad or good per se about having a high or a low beta, but it's just important to understand the relative importance of wealth and income in society. So let me show you, you know, the evolution over the past few decades. So here you have, these are the top 8 developed economies in the world, US, Japan, Germany, France, UK, Italy, Canada, Australia. And this is the ratio of private wealth to national income in all of these countries. So you can see that, you know, every country in 1970 was between 2 and 3 years, and every country today is between 4 and 7 years. So, you know, if you come with a theory that tells you that this is a constant, you know, you have a hard time explaining that. Now, you can also see that, you know, the story of capital is always pretty chaotic. So look at Japan between 1985 and 1980. You know, they go from 5 to 7 years of national income in wealth in 4 years. You know, even with a Japanese saving rate, there's no way you can accumulate wealth so fast. You know, you will need a 50% saving rate per year to accumulate 2 years of income in 4 years. That doesn't come from savings. That comes from a real estate price effect. So, you know, the price of real estate, the price of the stock market goes up. And, you know, you can see that in Ireland, you can see that in Spain, you can see that in France in different time periods. So, but what's interesting, and you see Japan in the early 1990s, the price of asset goes down. But what's interesting is that if you look over a longer period, you know, it's more than a local price effect. You know, in the sense that every country, you know, this is about 50% of world GDP, this set of countries, so that's quite important. You know, this is clearly, you know, every country was between 2 and 3, now every country is between 4 and 7, so there's a clear trend. Now, at the same time that the private wealth was building, as you know, public wealth was going down. So here, you know, I have put, so this is the private wealth at the top. Now, this is public wealth as a fraction of national income. So public wealth is defined in the same way as private wealth. You take real estate assets, financial assets, minus financial debt, so public debt. Okay? Now, you can see this can be negative. So Italy right now has negative public wealth, which means that even, you know, according to the Bank of Italy balance sheet, you know, if they were to sell all the Italian public assets and all Italian financial assets, you know, they will still not be able to reimburse all the public debt. So, you know, that's what a negative means. Now, you can see that in every country, Over the period, you have a decline in public capital. But the important thing is that, you know, the increase, so you have a decline of public capital because you have a rise in public debt, and you have a decline in public assets through privatization, typically. And sometimes, you know, some of this privatization of public assets were done at very cheap prices. So in a way, this was like transferring public wealth to private wealth. And, you know, this happens in other countries as well, like, you know, Russia in a much more extreme manner. But what's important is that, you know, there's more than that, than just the transfer from public to private wealth. You can see that the increase in private wealth has been a lot bigger than the decline in public wealth, which, again, is relatively good news, you know, because this means, you know, sometime in Europe, you know, we feel that, you know, we should be ashamed of with all this public debt that we are going to leave to our children, and, you know, this is very bad, and, you know, we should really be ashamed of that. And, you know, of course, it's a shame, but at the same time, you know, we are going to leave more private wealth to our children as a fraction of GDP that we've ever left for an entire century, at least for those of us who will have wealth to leave. Okay? And the increase in private wealth as a fraction of GDP has been much bigger than the decline of public wealth. So our national wealth, which is by definition the sum of the two, has actually increased as a fraction of GDP. So in other words, you know, European countries and Japan, you know, are rich. It is our governments which are poor, which is a problem. You know, this requires us to fix the problem. But, you know, it's much easier to fix problem if we have a lot of wealth than if we were all indebted. And, you know, it's very important to have this in mind, because sometimes in the European debate, we only talk about the debt and, you know, we don't talk about the assets. And, you know, I don't know about Ireland, but in where, you know, the problem is a bit different. But in France, you know, sometimes people feel that, you know, they are being owned by the Emir of Qatar or the Bank of China. But, you know, at this stage, you know, Europe has actually, as a rule, has more financial assets in the rest of the world than the rest of the world has in Europe. And the net national wealth of Europe as a fraction of GDP has not been higher for an entire century. So our macroeconomic fundamentals, our financial fundamentals are, you know, much, much better than anywhere else in the world. And you know, I've never been as good for such a long time. So, you know, then it's a problem of organization, but, you know, per se, this is certainly a good news. So let me accelerate a little bit, and, you know, I'm not going to show you everything here. What we have observed over this period of time is at the same time an increase in what I call the beta, the ratio of capital to income, or the ratio of wealth to income, and also a ratio of what I call in the book the alpha, which is the capital share in national income. So what is the capital share? This is the share of our national income going to profits, dividend, interest, rent. Okay, so this is the share of income going to capital, generally speaking, net of capital depreciation. And you can see, you know, so this is the same group of countries that I have shown you before. And over the past decades, we have at the same time an increase in beta and an increase in alpha. So if you want, we have at the same time an increase in the quantity of capital in relation to income or GDP, and an increase in the share of GDP going to capital. So in the standard, in some standard textbook model in economics, we actually assume that this is a constant. But as you can see, again, this is not a constant. And in fact, this doesn't have to be a constant. You know, if you take the standard economic model with what economists call a production function and the, how much you can substitute capital and labor in the production function, the easy way to explain why you have a rise in the capital share together with a rise in the quantity of capital would be to assume an elasticity of substitution between capital and labor that's slightly above one. So in concrete terms, what does this mean, more substitution between capital and labor? It just means that you can do a lot with capital. So, you know, an extreme example, I think you've all heard about the Amazon made this announcement at the end of last year that they wanted to replace delivery workers by drones. And, you know, that's an extreme example of capital-labor substitution. So many people thought it was a joke initially, but apparently this is not a joke. You know, many people also thought that Amazon already treats their workers like drones, so after all, you know, this is not so. But So that will be in an economic language, you know, that will be an infinite elasticity of substitution. So in order to get this, you don't need to go that far. You just need to have an elasticity of substitution that's a bit above one. Now, for now on, you know, maybe one day robots will be a very important part of the capital stock. This is not what's playing a role today. You know, in this evolution, the capital-intensive sector are first real estate. So, you know, there's a lot of real estate and increase in the rent in GDP that explains this evolution. The other capital-intensive sector are the energy sector. So, you know, real estate, energy are driving this much more than robots. But, you know, in the future, nobody knows how important this will be. Okay, so let me move to now the issue of wealth inequality in the long run. So again, the fact that we have a lot of wealth is not bad per se. The problem is who owns the robots. You know, if we have an economy in the long run where robots are very important, there's a lot of capital assets that play a big role. You know, this is fine if everybody has an equal share in the stock of robots and we can all go on vacation when the robots are working. But the problem, of course, is if the robots are all owned by a small fraction of the population, or the real estate are all owned by a little fraction of the population. So this is the issue of wealth concentration. And here, what's important to have in mind is that in all European countries, you know, wealth inequality was extremely high until World War I. This is what I call here the classic patrimonial society, which you see, you know, in the novels of Jane Austen or Balzac, or, you know, any novelist in the 19th century or 18th century will tell you the story of extremely concentrated wealth. Now, today, wealth concentration is still very high. You know, it's still a lot larger than income concentration. So, you know, we've seen income concentration for the United States at the beginning. You know, the share going to the top 10 has gone from 1/3 to 1/2. Whereas for wealth, it's always more than 1/2 for the top 10. You know, so even today, that would be typically 60% in most European countries, over 70% in the United States. So this is a lot more, you know, wealth is a lot more concentrated than income. Basically, the bottom half of the population has no wealth, sometimes as negative wealth if they have higher mortgage than the value of their property, or more debt, more consumer debt. And even the next 40% in the population, which I call the middle class, the patrimonial middle class in the book, you know, has typically 20-30% of aggregate wealth today. So wealth is very concentrated, but at the same time, it is less concentrated than a century ago. So the rise of a patrimonial middle class is a very important change. Now the question is, will it last? You know, will the share going to the middle class increase in the future? Will it reduce? And, you know, that's one of the key questions I'm trying to address in the book. And, you know, it's very complicated to come with an answer because there are very different effects going on. What we get, you know, if you look at this example in France where we have some of the oldest data series, because in particular, starting with the French Revolution, we have a sort of very systematic system of wealth registration at death, so you can go into the archives and measure wealth inequality pretty well. What you can see is that you have very high inequality of wealth until World War I. You have a decline starting in World War I until the 60s, 70s. Then you have a stabilization of a small rise. You know, for the recent period, it could be that the rise is a bit larger than that. In the United States, it is significantly larger. For Europe, nobody really knows because the data that we have for wealth is not so good. So it could be that the rise has been larger. In any case, you know, what's quite striking, you know, if you look at this and try to explain the long run evolution. One key finding is that there was no decline in wealth concentration until World War I. That's quite striking because in France, you know, in 1913, there was a lot of denial that wealth inequality was large. So in particular, there was always this big comparison that people like to make in France with Britain. And the big claim was, okay, we've done the French Revolution, so, you know, we don't need to do anything else. So now we don't have an aristocracy, so we are a country of equals, and we don't need progressive taxation of inheritance. You know, that's good for Britain because they are a Downton Abbey society. They, you know, they have an aristocracy, they have land, but in France. And in fact, if you look at the data, wealth inequality was just as extreme in France as in Britain in 1913 because, you know, at that time, land, you know, it's only in Downton Abbey that it matters, but in the actual structure of national wealth, I've not shown you the graph, but it's less than 5% of national wealth. And, you know, as far as the accumulation of financial assets, international investment, real estate, business capital is concerned, you know, the fact that France is a republic rather than a monarchy does not really matter. And I think what matters more, if you want to explain why the concentration of wealth prior to 1913 is not very different than in the 18th century before the revolution and probably even a bit higher, the best explanation is probably the following. You know, in any model of wealth accumulation, you know, the differential between the rate of return to capital and the growth rate is going to have a very large impact on the magnitude of wealth inequalities in the long run, because this will get initial wealth inequalities to be magnified. So, you know, take the example, if the rate of return to capital is 5% and the growth rate is 1%, basically you only need to reinvest one-fifth of what you get from the return to your capital to keep up with the size of the economy. Okay? So sometimes, you know, some people will not do that. You know, some people will consume more. Some people will dilapidate the wealth. Some families will have too many children. Some will have too few. You know, all sorts of things happened in the life of a family, so that there will always be some people going down, some people going up. So inequality is not going to rise forever because R is 5% and G equals 1%. But for a given structure of shocks to family histories, rate of return, families go bankrupt, families make huge profit, for a given structure of such shocks, a higher gap between R and G will tend to lead to a higher inequality of wealth. So, you know, what's important, you know, some people sometimes, you know, are surprised by this idea that the rate of return to capital can be bigger than the growth rate forever. So it's important to have in mind that, in fact, you know, during most of the history of mankind, this was really obvious to everybody that R was bigger than G. You know, if you take, you know, the best estimates we have about the growth rate of world GDP and rate of return for average assets, you know, during most of the history of mankind, you know, the growth rate was very close to 0%. So, you know, if you read again, if you go back to Jane Austen or Balzac, you know, for them it was obvious that R was bigger than G because, you know, the growth rate was basically zero. You know, there was you have the same, almost the same population and the same structure of output from one generation to the next. You know, the growth rate until the Industrial Revolution was less than 0.5% per year and certainly less than 0.1% per year. Whereas the rate of return to capital was typically between 4 and 5%. So for instance, you know in any of these novels, you know, if you want to have an annual income of £1,000, you know, you need a capital of £20,000 typically. And it is so obvious and so well known to everybody that, you know, you don't even have to explain it in a novel. And in the same paragraph, you will go from the capital value to the annual income because every reader will understand, you know, how you go from a capital value to an annual income. You know, this is so important for the life of people, for what kind of living standards you're going to access, who you're going to marry with, what you're going to do with your life. You know, this is not just economics. This is really serious matter. So R bigger than G, in a way, was the very foundation of society. This is what allowed a group of owners to live off their capital and to do something else in life than to care about their own survival. And, you know, they could go to the ballroom, do scientific activities, politics, you know, whatever they want. But, you know, this was really the foundation of society. Now, the Industrial Revolution and modern industrial growth has changed this basic relationship much less than what we typically believe, in the sense that the growth rate has increased, But you know, in the long run, even with a lot of innovation, a lot of productivity growth, probably productivity growth rates are not really higher than 1 to 1.5, maybe 1 to 2% per year. And the only reason why you have, you know, 3 to 4% per year growth rate in the 20th century, at least in the second half of the 20th century, is first because of post-war reconstruction. So you know, particularly in Europe or in Japan, we have huge growth rate in the 50s, 60s, 70s, but that was because of the reconstruction after the war. And the other big explanation, and more positive, less tragic explanation, is the demographic transition. Okay, so about half of the growth rate of 4% that you have between 1950 and 2012 actually comes from population growth. Okay? And we will see in a minute that population growth is still important, but according to United Nations projections, population growth is supposed to go to zero, so that world output growth at the end of the day will be only productivity growth if you don't have any population growth. And this, you know, here I put 1.5% in the long run. You know, some people believe that it will be even less than that. You know, it's important to remember that 1.5% per year is already quite large when you do it over a long period of time. And I think it will be a mistake, you know, to imagine that, growth rates are going to return to 4 or 5% per year. So in any case, the point is that the gap between the rate of return and the growth rate is likely to increase again in the future. And it's important to have in mind that it's only due to a very unusual set of circumstances that during the 20th century, you know, the gap was smaller because the growth rate was particularly large. Now, the other unusual circumstance, of course, is the big shocks to capital that occurred during the 20th century. So this is a pre-tax and pre-destruction rate of return. But if you take into account the destructions that were made during World War I, World War II, and the taxation of capital that was put in place after the war, then this is what you get for the after-tax and after-destruction rate of return. And so you can see that these very unusual circumstances in the 20th century, for a very long time period, you know, have made the after-tax rate of return actually less than the growth rate. Now, this is unlikely to happen again in the future, well, you know, unless we have another set of destruction, but you know, this is not something you want. So, you know, it's really due to very specific shocks, you know, destruction and a lot of taxation to pay for the war, you know, inflation that made the public debt disappear after World War II, and which in effect was like a huge expropriation on private wealth. Well, you know, maybe this could happen again, but well, you know, short of that, you know, the gap between the rate of return and the growth rate is likely to be higher. Just to let me try to get to the conclusion and give you a more concrete example of R bigger than G. Okay, so here this is data coming from the Forbes billionaire list. So let me say right away that this is not particularly reliable data. And you know, I'm a bit ashamed to do that. But at the same time, you have to be pragmatic. You know, it's a bit sad. We live at a time where people have to read magazines to know about wealth. You know, I would prefer that people could buy, IMF report or Eurostat publications, but they will not find the information. So, you know, because official wealth survey typically rely only on self-reported wealth information and are not reliable at all regarding the top of the distribution. And so what you get in this ranking of large fortunes is certainly not perfect, but I think it's probably more reliable than what you get in self-reported wealth survey. In fact, some people right now at the European Central Bank are trying to correct the household wealth survey that is now coordinated by the European Central Bank in order to upgrade the top part of the distribution using the Pareto coefficient coming from this Forbes ranking and other ranking of fortunes. And you know, this is very exploratory, but you know, one of the problems we have, in fact, I think, is a lack of financial transparency. And you know, one reason why I like global progressive wealth tax, or at least you know, automatic exchange of information about assets between countries, is that this is a way to produce more financial transparency and more information about wealth. Anyway, for the time being, we have to do with what we have, and what we have is this. So here, you know, usually what, so I start in 1987, because this is when Forbes started publishing their global list of billionaires. So usually what people do with this billionaire list is they say, okay, there are more and more billionaires in the world. But you know, if you have a growing world economy, this is not too surprising that you have more and more billionaires. So here what I do is slightly more sophisticated, is that I take a fixed fraction of the world population at the top and I look at how their average wealth has been rising. Okay. Now, of course, these are not the same people throughout the period. Okay. You have some people who go down because they dilapidate their wealth or, you know, whatever happens to them, and some new billionaires that come in, coming from emerging countries or from, you know, successful, you know, Irish investors, and, you know, I don't know how many there are, but anyway. Now, wherever these people come from, if we were in an equilibrium of the world distribution of wealth, if inequality has converged to a constant level, you know, the top should rise at the same speed as the average. Now, as you can see, this is not exactly what we have according to the data, because the top is rising more than 3 times faster than the average. So the growth rate of top wealth holders has been, according to the Forbes data, between 6 and 7% per year between 1987 and 2013 in real terms, so above inflation. You know, if it's only for 1 or 2 years, you don't care too much. But, you know, if it's over 26-year period, you know, it's a big growth. Now, if you look at the average, so this is at the world level. So world GDP over this period has increased at 3.3% per year. But it's really important to have in mind that a lot of that is population. Okay, so in fact, world adult population has been increasing at 1.9% per year. Okay, so that average GDP per capita and average income, you know, per adult has increased at only 1.4% per year. Okay, so more than half of the growth is just absorbed by rising population. So, you know, population is supposed to stabilize 20, 30, 40 years from now in the world, according to the United Nations. But of course, nobody really knows. You know, it could be that people decide to have more children. You know, we don't know. But according to the projections we have, this is supposed to stabilize pretty soon. But this has not stabilized yet. Okay, right now, the world population growth, you know, when you look in 2014 at the world GDP growth rate of 3.4%, you know, again, half of it is population growth. So a big part of the feeling of growth that we have in the world today comes from the fact that, you know, the size of the world, if you want, is still growing. You know, the size of the population is still growing. So anyway, the per capita income, which is a better estimate of, you know, living standards, average living standards, you know, has been going up at only 1.4% per year, which is still, you know, a lot better than zero, of course, which is about what we have in the Eurozone right now. But you know, 1.4% is not that much. Now, average wealth has been going up at 2.1%, so a bit faster than average income. This is because of the rise in the beta. You know, remember, wealth to income ratio is rising over this period in rich countries and over the world on average. So this means that average wealth is rising a bit faster than average income. But as you see, this is still only 2.1%. So whereas the top is rising between 6 and 7%. So, you know, even if the Forbes data is not perfectly reliable, and, you know, I'm ready to accept that we can do better, but for the time being, you know, this is what we have, and every other magazine or every financial institution, you know, Credit Suisse, Merrill Lynch, that have published global wealth report have similar conclusion. So even if this data is not very good, you know, it will be, you know, if the top is getting 6-7% instead of 2% for the average, you know, it will be surprising that even with better data, this would reverse this conclusion. But, you know, we don't know. You know, we have, you know, the data we have on wealth, and in particular large wealth. You know, in particular, it could be that this is happening only for billionaires, you know, for people who are really extremely rich, and that for people who have only 10 or 20 or 50 million, this is the rise is much less fast. And in a way, you know, it will be more important to know what's happening at the level of 10, 20, 50, 100, because there are a lot more people. You know, after all, billionaires, you know, you have relatively few of them. So their share in total world wealth, you know, has increased from 1 to 2.5 or 3%. But it will take another 30 years, even with this growth, before they own, you know, 20 or 30% of world wealth. Well, I'm not sure this is really so reassuring, but still, you know, what really matters is what's happening at the level of 5, 10, 50 million euro. And probably these groups are rising much less fast than the very top. We don't really know. So the other piece of data that I want to show you, and then I conclude, or maybe you should tell me how long I have already, probably.
Say 5 more minutes.
Okay, that's exactly what I need, yes. Okay, is this telling me that I should stop, or no, this is the... okay, no, this is... Okay, so this is another piece of data that I use in the book, which sort of confirms this view about R bigger than G for large wealth portfolio. So this is data about the university endowments in the US. The only reason why I use this is because this is much, we actually have a lot of data about how, what kind of rate of return these large capital endowments are getting. So these universities publish a lot of data. So they have, we have very detailed information on their portfolio and on their annual return, which we don't have for the Forbes list. You know, we don't have the detailed portfolio report for the rich individuals in the world. So I use this just because it's a good way to see how large portfolios are doing. So as you can see, they are doing pretty well. You know, and in particular, the bigger the portfolio, the better they are doing. So, you know, let me say, maybe the period between 1980 and 2010 was particularly good for a number of assets. So maybe the rate of return, you know, will be smaller in the, somewhat smaller in the future. But still, you know, here they are so high that, you know, it's important to have this in mind as a benchmark. So you have 850 universities in the US with capital endowment. So some are very rich, some are much less rich. As you can see, the rates of return, so these are real annual rate of return after deduction of inflation and after deduction of all, you know, wealth management fees. Okay, so this is really the pure rate of return. Okay, you have paid everything you need to pay to get your rate of return. And probably that's part, you know, the scale effects in portfolio management are part of the explanation as to why the rate of return is so much higher, you know, for big portfolios and for smaller portfolios. I mean, 6% is already quite good. I mean, even the smaller portfolios are pretty big portfolios, you know, if you... But for the bigger ones, like, you know, Harvard, right now, the Harvard endowment is $30 billion, or actually 35, 40, this is going up very fast. They spend about 0.3% in management fees, so this is very little, but 0.3% of $30 billion is already $100 million. So this allows you to pay a good group of wealth managers. And what seems to be happening is that this allows them to access, you know, very sophisticated financial products or, you know, private equity or complex financial derivatives on commodities and natural resources, which, you know, you're not going to access with your $100,000 or €100,000 portfolio because you're not going to have the advice of a group of wealth managers that you can pay $100 million. Okay? So, you know, maybe you will have the advice of your brother-in-law or someone you know, which could be good and could be not so good. But, you know, in any case, you know, I think that's part of the, you know, if for very large portfolio, you know, if it costs you 0.3% of your asset and it gets you a return of 10% instead of 6%, you know, it's a good deal. And you could pay even twice as much, you know. So I think that's part of the explanation for the very high growth of large wealth. You know, that's not the only explanation. You also have a lot of entrepreneurial wealth, you know, in the top wealth in the world. But you can see that this is not an entrepreneurial wealth effect. You know, it's not that these universities have invented new products. You know, they have just paid wealth managers to invest their wealth, and this is the return they are getting. And the higher the initial portfolio, the higher the return. So, you know, as long as these are universities that are doing useful things with the money, and, you know, I'm sure Harvard is doing lots of useful things, and, you know, they are publishing books, actually, they're making money out of these books, rather than... But anyway, you know, as long as these are universities that are doing useful things, you know, that's fine. Maybe this creates a problem in terms of for bottom universities in the US and inequality between universities, but that was not my point. My point is that if the same is happening at the level of the individual distribution of wealth, you can see that, you know, this is potentially quite disturbing for the long run evolution. So, you know, the most natural, you know, if let me, you know, if this is a summary of what's happening, you know, with the top rising three times faster than the average. You know, of course, the ideal solution would be to have a progressive wealth tax so as to ensure that basically the different groups in the distribution are rising at comparable speed, you know, in the long run. Well, you know, it depends what's your target in terms of distribution of wealth, but you know, if you want to keep the same share as today for the top, the middle class, the bottom, etc., then you know, the most natural way to control, you know, the dynamics of the wealth distribution would be to have this progressive wealth tax. Now, you know, this will require first, you know, a lot better information in order to know what's happening to these different wealth groups. And I think, you know, this is where international cooperation, automatic transmission of information can play a very big role. So, you know, many people say that this will never happen. You know, I am much less pessimistic than most people, and you know, we can talk more about it in the discussion. You know, I think the entire history of taxation is full of surprise. You know, if you look at the evolution, and you know, I can't resist showing you the evolution of the top income tax rate in a number of countries, you know, US, UK, Germany, France. You know, one century ago, there was no income tax, or you know, very low top income tax rate, and then it went up to 90% in the US and the UK, and then it went in the other direction with the same patience that we often see, you know, in the US and UK debate about taxation and inequality. You know, these two countries have gone very far in one direction and very far in the other direction. You know, France and Germany have been a lot more stable countries, I should say, in terms of taxation. Except, you see, Germany, you know, there is one time period where Germany has a 90% tax rate on very high incomes, which is 1945, 1948. You know, by the way, these tax rates, you know, when they were applying not above 33,000 euros, like today's top rate in Ireland, they were applying above $1 million or $2 million. And this is why this did not destroy American capitalism, you know, because this was applied only to really excessive incomes. And you know, there's very little evidence that it's really that useful to pay a manager $5 million rather than $1 million. So, you know, this tax rate, you know, did not harm the US economy in any way. Some people think in Britain that this has harmed the British economy. I think the British economy was harmed by many other problems, including low investment in education, and I think that was much more important. But anyway, the only time when Germany had a 90% top tax rate is when the tax policy of Germany was set by the Americans. Okay, this was this was the Allied Control Council in 1945, 1948 that was setting the tax rate in Germany. That's for real. I mean, this is not a joke. And then when West Germany took back its sovereignty in 1950, they reduced their tax rate very quickly, because they thought it was a crazy American idea to have a 90% top tax rate. And it was the same in Japan. The only time, you know, if I was to show you Japan on the same graph, and I have it in the appendix of the book online, the only time where you have a 90% top tax rate is 1945 to 1948, when it was set by the Americans. And so why were the Americans doing that? And let me conclude for real with this. You know, it was not to punish the Germans or the Japanese, because the Americans were doing the same at home at the same time. So this was really part of what they viewed as the civilization package, if you wish. You know, they came with the democratic institutions, which they felt was necessary for Germany and Japan. But they thought that, you know, in order for democracy to work, you also need to implement the fiscal institution that prevent the democracy from becoming a plutocracy with excessive concentration of income and wealth at the very top. So I know that, you know, these things seem very exotic to us today, and you know, this is like ancient history, but you know, I think it's important to realize that this is part of our common history, that you know, the issue of inequality has not started 10 years ago, the issue of public debt, you know, we've already had huge public debt in the past. And you know, putting all these issues into historical perspective, you know, I think it's important to address them in the future and try to have a bit more of, you know, informed and quiet discussion about taxation. Although, you know, I can see that many people are not ready for a quiet discussion on these tax rates, but all I'm doing is to, you know, I have not invented the tax policy of these four countries for a century. You know, this is just what happened. I think it's useful to be aware of this long historical perspective from which we come from. And
this is where I will stop.